Well, hello there, malty, mysterious malt men and women. And thank you to Charlie00 for that mega malty prompt. Ralphie here, and welcome to Whisky Review 172, which is titled Recommended Older Blended Whiskies. And here they are. I have three of them, and this should tide things quite nicely over till the new year in 2011, along with my cigar reviews. You will probably notice as I hold them up to the camera to give you a darn good look that I've already reviewed this one, J&B Reserve 15-year-old blended Scotch whiskey. This is the youngest of the older recommended. Here's the middle-aged, the middle one is 17-year-old Ballantine's blended Scotch whiskey. There we go. There's the label. And here's the third one. This is 21-year-old Campbelltown Loch. It tends to be a feature with the malt snobs, of which I constantly strive not to be, that blended whiskies tend to get put in a back burner. In other words, if you're offered a blended whisky of any sort, well, it'll do, it's better than nothing. But of course, single malt whiskies are everything. And I don't think this is entirely the case, particularly when so many single malt whiskies at quite a relatively high price are in fact packaged like a blended Scotch. At 40% with the chill filtration, with the colouring, and with the blending, because single malts still get blended. Yes, they do, unless they're single cask. Albeit that with single malt whiskies, all the blending comes from casks from the one malt distillery, and it's important to keep that in mind. If you have up to 10 casks involved in blending for a single malt bottling, fine, you still get a very clear perspective of the single malt signature from the still and the wood. But when you've got hundreds of casks getting put together to make up a batch of single malt whiskey, things get slightly hazy, slightly fuzzy in terms of the signature, the smell and the taste. Not a lot. You need to be experienced to notice it, malt mates. But as you go down the journey of maltness, you will discover these things for yourself. Back to blends. Where will we start? Well, when you're reading up in Scotch whisky history, they start back at 1495 with Friar John Corr and his 16 balls. But that's for another day. We're going to move on quite a number of centuries after the brutal economic suppression of the, particularly in the Highlands of Scotland, where whisky was, it wasn't even because the whisky, illegal whisky producers were not paying the tax. It was the fact that in remote communities, whisky became a valid independent currency in its own right. And if you're going to defeat people and suppress people, it's very important that you don't just send in the soldiers, but you do so economically. And that is the reason that after an act of parliament in the 1700s something, I'm not going to bore you with the dates at the moment, it's for another presentation. Well, basically, distillation of whiskey was licensed, it was legalised, it was taxed, and quite heavily. And as has been mentioned recently in an interview with Francis at Dathmill Distillery, for every litre of whiskey of spirit produced in the UK and sold in the UK, the duty is £23. A very high margin indeed, particularly when you consider that newspapers and books and children's clothes, they don't even pay VAT. Yeah, and I suppose it's to the back of people's mind. Well, if taxes were actually sensibly spent and you could see what taxes were spent on, fine, raise the taxes. But I'm not going to go down that road. Back to the blended whisky. Blended Scotch was basically created by Andrew Usher about 1860 when he produced, says me, reading my notes here, yes. you know, even, you know, I'm not an expert, but I'm sure even the experts have their notes near to hand. 1860, blended malt and grain whiskey together, and he produced the first true Scotch blended whiskey called Old Vatted Glenlivet, in which most of the output of Glenlivet Malt Distillery was shipped down to Edinburgh and at the new massive grain distillery called North British, which is the only spirit producer now in the city of Edinburgh. It was basically the single malt whiskey was mixed with grain whiskey. Now, the grain whiskey then, as is now, could be a mixture of corn, wheat, barley, and basically the spirit was produced using the coffee and anise coffee, or the continuous still. Now, my recommendation to you is once you've visited a few single malt distilleries and seen how beautifully polished the stills are and how, you know, well rehearsed some of these tour guides are, because they have their mystery customers coming round to keep them on their toes and pull them up if they so much as say something that isn't off the auto cue that they have to dress rehearse before they take the tours round. It's a sign of the times. See if you can get yourself along to a grain distillery like North British Distillery or perhaps Strathclyde in Glasgow, because they are a lot more industrial, but in many ways they're a lot more honest in their appearance and the way they produce the spirit. The grain is blended out. Andrew Usher, well, it actually was his wife, Mrs. Usher, who should get all the credit, not Andrew. He was the businessman. He put the money into the project, but it was his wife, who was a tea blender, Mrs. Usher, who actually, apparently, allegedly, but I believe it, blended the grain and the malt whiskies together in the right proportions that it became ever so pleasant to drink. And bear in mind, in those days, a lot of malt whisky was drunk very young and was frankly a rough. So with the natural sweetness that you get, particularly from corn grain whisky spirit, that sweetness would cover the roughness of the malt whisky. Anyway, moving on, further down my notes now. Blah blah, output of Glenlivet, well, most of the output of Glenlivet Distillery went into the hugely successful Old Vatted Glenlivet blended Scotch. And currently the distillery is producing over 60 million litres a year, not just of grain spirit for these fine blended whiskies, some of them, but also vodka and gin. There we go. And carbon dioxide, by the way. They're collecting the carbon dioxide because it is very much an industrial process, coming off the top of the fermentation vessels and liquefying them back into stuff that can be put into canisters and squished into your carbonated drinks. Let's concentrate on these three. I've already reviewed this, gave it 84 points. The other two, I've bought them, so I'm quite happy to review them for you. Ballantine, 17-year-old. I'll be reviewing this one next. It tends to be a big hit with some of the experts. And I think they slightly over-egged the pudding, to be honest, in the praise for it. But it's a thoroughly decent blended, an old-school blended whiskey, in fact, where the balance of of between the peaty malts and a really well-put-together grain whisky, which means good marrying of the two spirits, the grain and the single malt, together to produce where basically two become one. That's what marriage of spirits is. And here we have, finally, Campbelltown Loch. I'll be reviewing this after the Ballantines. A very good example of a small, independent, craft-orientated distiller producing an old-style, high malt content, excellent quality blended whiskey. There we have. Ralphie.com, that's me, and I will see you soon. Bye.